Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you how SpaceX will be able to build the offshore launch platform for Starship and Super Heavy.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. What's happened in Boca Chica, part 118? Isn't that incredible? SpaceX is producing so much news, there is so much worth analyzing, worth explaining, that it fills two episodes per week and it's not slowing down at all. It's rather speeding up. If we consider Starhopper the liftoff of the Starship program, serial number 4 would have been Max-Q, the point of the highest resistance. Many failures in a row, rumor that Starships would never fly, confusion on what SpaceX actually was trying to accomplish. Many didn't lose faith though. We kept watching Boca Chica and SpaceX waiting for the big relief. That one breakthrough needed to make the Starship prototypes fly. And it happened. Serial number 5 and 6 took off without a problem. They showed the world that these strange-looking prototypes might actually be the right way to go. And as always, SpaceX did not rest for a second. The roller coaster ride has just begun. Let me show you once again what SpaceX is up to now and will be in the next couple of weeks. At the construction site, the high bay, now towering over everything else, is finally starting to look like a building and not a loose cage. A lot of progress has been made on the sides and the rooftop, and the SpaceX workers are fleshing out the construction. Musk stated it with a big maybe, but if SpaceX really wants to have a Super Heavy prototype by next month, this building will be needed very soon. First stackings can still be done in the mid bay, but as soon as it grows larger, the high bay will be needed to finish the building process. Right now it's hard to say if they can actually make that time frame, but if anyone can, it's them. Why am I so confident? Because of this. What you're looking at here is the mid bay, and it's too small already. These are the Starship prototypes serial number 5, 6 and 8. 5 and 8 inside the mid bay and 6 sitting in the open. Two of them already performed a flight. The third one will receive 3 engines, a nose cone and flaps for the first time. That's not all though. Serial number 9 is already in the works, and if that doesn't show you something, here's more. Let me introduce you to serial number 10. To be more precise, serial number 10's forward dome. This is the uppermost dome on top of the main methane tank. And it's already been sleeved as well. These pictures provided by Boca Chica Gal once again show the insane speed at which SpaceX is moving forward. If we cut away half the hull of a Starship, the internals become visible, and that makes it much easier to explain what part Mary took a picture of. This is where the forward dome is located, and these are the ring segments you just saw being put around the dome as a sleeve. It's the typical Starship segment approach we got so used to seeing. I'm not done though, do you know what this is? It's not the sleeve for serial number 10 at all, if you got confused. These parts look so much alike, right? SpaceX though is doing a good job labeling them. And this one has a label too. Drum roll. This is a segment for Starship serial number 11. Absolutely incredible. And look at the welds up close. These should already be 304L stainless steel rings, and the welds couldn't look much better than this. Absolutely straight and very even. This is likely what serial number 8, 9, 10 and 11 will look like once finished. Each one getting one step closer to the first production level Starship. The prototype program definitely is heading into the right direction. When will we see serial number 11 fly? Next month? November? Early 2021? What's your guess? As always, tell me in the comments. Fantastic work by Eric again with the renders. You rock, Eric. Check out his Twitter in the description for more. Speaking of fast progress, serial number 7.1, the 304L stainless steel test tank, was already rolled out to the launch site while we were still editing episode 117. Another awesome picture by Mary from NASASpaceflight.com. It's been at the test site for a couple of days now, waiting for first pressure tests to give more test data on how 304L stainless behaves when turned into a Starship prototype segment. As of recording the episode, SpaceX had the following test dates announced. September 10th, which was before release of this episode, September 14th, and two backup dates on the 15th and the 16th. Those dates, according to SpaceX official information, are for serial number 7.1 pressure tests. Due to weather being a factor and SpaceX's tendency to change these dates quite often, it might be that they are already outdated though. Everything seems to be getting closer right now. SpaceX is building 4 different Starships. According to Elon Musk, a Super Heavy prototype might already be finished by next month. The orbital launch pad is progressing, and SpaceX is actively working on a solution for offshore launches. As much as 2020 was a strange year for all of us, SpaceX did not slow down at all. What's also to be expected for this year is the next Starship presentation, also announced by Elon Musk for October. So SpaceX made it from pressure test failures to 2 hops, large infrastructure improvements, 4 Starships in the works that should receive flaps, and a possible Super Heavy flight in 1 year. What's to come for 2021? What are the set milestones, and what is still needed to make Starships operational? Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. Starship offshore pad construction. Today I'll finish what I started on Tuesday and give you an overview of what SpaceX would possibly need to build a proposed Starship offshore launch pad and what facilities such a pad would need. What Musk and SpaceX are proposing for Starship and Super Heavy launches is nothing new. Sea Launch, for example, may be the most prominent example for such an endeavor, a cooperation between Norway, Russia, Ukraine and the United States, and managed by Boeing, has managed to launch 32 rockets off their Odyssey mobile sea launch platform from 1995 to 2014. China has the Long March 11, a small 4-stage rocket that can be launched from vehicles or from a special sea launch platform. A first sea launch occurred in 2019. All sea launch projects have one thing in common though. They launch rather small rockets. In SpaceX's case, it would be the largest rocket ever to fly into orbit. So what will SpaceX likely do differently? As seen on episode 117, SpaceX's plan is to launch Super Heavy from an offshore platform. Multiple launches per day and an incredible 72 meganewtons of thrust will force SpaceX to do it, as an exclusion zone for such a large rocket would be around 30 kilometers or 18 miles wide, according to Elon Musk himself. This is not possible on land anywhere close to the populated areas, and coasts tend to be very populated all around the world. In fact, around 40% of the world's total population live on or near a coast. So this is what SpaceX will likely have to do. But how is SpaceX going to do it? Since Super Heavy is such a massive rocket, SpaceX will need a large launch platform. Something comparable to an offshore oil rig. Especially the Gulf of Mexico has an incredibly large amount of abandoned and decommissioned oil rigs. More than 27,000 abandoned oil wells are sitting out there in the Gulf. Over 400 oil rigs have been deliberately sunk into the Gulf's waters, as it's a cheap way of getting rid of them. It endangers the environment, and it's a problem that's widespread. According to Greenpeace, there were over 2,600 oil rigs in the Gulf waiting to be decommissioned in 2014. They are large, cheap, and can be rather easily modified. Why not use those as a possible solution for Super Heavy launches? Tow it to where it's supposed to be, modify and renovate it, and the new SpaceX Sea Launch Complex can be put to use to get us to the Moon and to Mars. And this is exactly what Nick and I based our concept on. So what would SpaceX have to add or modify to get such an oil rig to be the next SpaceX Sea Launch Complex? The foundation would be provided at least partly by the oil rig itself. A few more foundation pillars and some extra deck space would probably be needed, as the distance between the structures should be kept as far away from each other as possible. Next up, we have a dock. SpaceX needs to be able to dock transport barges, ships to carry passengers to and from the platform, fuel, parts, rockets, all of it would have to arrive by boat. An elevator leads up to the platform for ease of access. The platform, of course, would also need a fuel farm. Maybe even fuel production to be able to produce fuel on site. There's room to spare on an oil rig. The landing platform would actually be optional. Landings could in theory be done on a drone ship, and starships and boosters could be lifted up again with a crane. If a 3 launch per day scenario is the goal though, landing on the platform would definitely be the quicker way to go. And the platform needs to be reachable by air, of course, so helicopter pads are needed. And they can already be found on every oil rig. Next, we have the mobile crane and its rail system. It's one of the largest pieces of equipment on the platform, but if SpaceX does it the way we depicted it, it would be rather simple to design. Then, of course, we need a large hangar for payload integration, maintenance, weather shelter, and so forth. Basically, the platform would need something comparable to the Boca Chica High Bay under construction right now. Added are some small buildings, those are just placeholders. They could also be under the deck for protection or look vastly different than what we came up with here. Last but not least, we have the launch mount itself and the launch support structure. The launch mount can be extremely flat, as most of the structure needed can be kept inside or under the deck. The exhaust would just hit the water. There's one aspect I still have to cover. When Musk is asked about the topic, he's all for protecting planet Earth and its inhabitants. That includes marine life. What happens to sea life around the platform if a super heavy launches? Sound is transmitted into the water and could seriously harm animals for miles around. There are a few possible solutions for it, but one, in my opinion, wins out on all the others.
It's the bubbly bubble curtains.
An air tube is being put on the sea floor in a wide enough circle around the platform, and air is pumped in. Through holes in the top, the air is released in the form of countless bubbles that then float to the surface. This is a method already in use for subsea pile driving work and seismic surveys. What you're seeing here is a mobile setup, but it can easily be set up as a permanent addition. The bubbles are a very effective sound suppression system, greatly hindering the sound waves from spreading out. This system could easily be turned on and off while launches are conducted. It could even be permanently kept running to keep fish and other sea life from entering the area in the first place. I hope this answers an important question which repeatedly got asked many times in the comments of the last episode. Impact on the environment could easily be kept to a minimum with cost-effective and easy-to-implement solutions. Elon Musk has shown one thing over and over again. When dealing with problems, the easy solutions sometimes require out-of-the-box thinking. The solutions provided by this approach often bring the cheapest and most practical fixes for seemingly complex problems. Easy-to-understand answers are sometimes hard to find, though. Today's sponsor is a specialist in this field. Brilliant is a problem-solving-based website and app with a hands-on approach, with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science. Brilliant helps you achieve your goals in STEM, starting with one small commitment to learning and building up to long-term challenge and growth. One brand new course on Brilliant, for example, tackles the at first very difficult topic of uncertainty. This course gives you mathematical tools for dealing with the flood of information in our lives. For example, can you put a number on how much you don't know? Sure you can. And when you learn something new, how should it change your beliefs about how the world works? Is there some formula for that? Why, yes, there is. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problem solving. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. And we're at the patron and YouTube member shoutout again. Today, my special thanks goes to Arthur Carty, Jared Frankly, Marcus Moller, Jason Letchworth, and many others. You rock! Their support enables me to stay afloat. All the money goes into the studio, hardware, support for the team, and into improving the show more and more each time. If you want to be part of the team too, talk to the community and to me on our Discord server, consider supporting the channel too. Every little bit helps immensely. Thank you. And the last words, as always, belong to the team. We're closing in on subscriber number 100,000, and they are right now behind the scenes working on my 100K livestream. It feels like a big happy family to me getting ready for the celebration of our hard work. Without you, this would have never happened, and you have my eternal gratitude. Thank you so much. You rock. The roller coaster ride has just begun.
It has just begun.
Last but not least, man, we have everything. Rockets and fuel and cats on the ground. It's all so good.
Stop doing this.
Which what?
Stop.
I hope this answers an important question, which
Slower.